Go on and play your spade, said Bernice. Then he argued it was hid behind the other card. Cheater. But still he would not play. He sat there, sad, and holding up the game. Make haste, said Bernice. I can't, he said finally. It's a jack. The only spade I got is a jack. I don't want to play my jack down under Frankie's queen. I'm not going to do it either. Frankie threw her cards down on the table. See, she said to Bernice, he don't even follow the first beginning law. He's a child. It's hopeless, hopeless, hopeless. Maybe so, said Bernice. Oh, Frankie said, I'm sick unto death. She sat with her bare feet on the rungs of the chair, her eyes closed, and her chest against the table edge. The red, greasy cards were messed together on the table, and the sight of them made Frankie sick. They had played cards after dinner every single afternoon. If you would eat those old cards, they would taste like a combination of all the dinners of that August, together with a sweaty-handed, nasty taste. Frankie swept the cards from the table. The wedding was bright and beautiful as snow, and the heart in her was mashed. She got up from the table. It is a known truth that gray-eyed people are jealous. I told you I wasn't jealous, Frankie said, and she was walking fast around the room. I couldn't be jealous of one of them without being jealous of them both. I associate the two of them together. Well, I were jealous when my foster brother married, said Bernice. I admit that when John married Clarina, I sent a warning I could tear the ears off her head. But, you see, I didn't. Clarina got ears like anybody else. And now, I love her. J.A., said Frankie. Janice and Jarvis. Isn't that the strangest thing? What? J.A., she said. Both their names begin with J.A. And what about it? Frankie walked around and around the kitchen table. If only my name was Jane, she said. Jane or Jasmine? I don't follow your frame of mind, said Bernice. Jarvis and Janice and Jasmine, see? No, said Bernice. By the way, I heard this morning on the radio that the French people are chasing the Germans out of Paris. Paris, Frankie repeated in a hollow tone. I wonder if it's against the law to change your name or to add to it. Naturally, it's against the law. Well, I don't care, she said. F. Jasmine Adams. On the staircase leading to her room, there was a doll, and John Henry brought it to the table and sat rocking it in his arms. Are you serious when you gave me this? He said. He pulled up the doll's dress and fingered the real panties and body waist. I will name her Belle. Frankie stared at the doll for a minute. I don't know what went on in Jarvis's mind when he brought me that doll. Imagine bringing me a doll. And Janice tried to explain that she had pictured me as a little girl. I had counted on Jarvis bringing me something from Alaska. Your face when you unwrapped that package was a study, said Bernice. It was a large doll with red hair and china eyes that opened and closed and yellow eyelashes. John Henry held her in a lying down position so that the eyes were shut, and he was now trying to open them by pulling up the eyelashes. Don't do that. It makes me nervous. In fact, take that doll somewhere out of my sight. John Henry took it to the back porch where he could pick it up when he went home. Her name is Lily Belle, he said. The clock ticked very slowly on the shelf above the stove, and it was only 5:45. The glare outside the window was still hard and yellow and bright. In the backyard, the shade beneath the arbor was black and solid. Nothing moved. From somewhere far away came the sound of whistling, and it was a grieving August song that did not end. The minutes were very long. Frankie went again to the kitchen mirror and stared at her own face. The big mistake I made was to get this close crew cut. For the wedding, I ought to have long, bright, yellow hair. Don't you think so? She stood before the mirror, and she was afraid. It was the summer of fear for Frankie, and there was one fear that could be figured in arithmetic with paper and a pencil at the table. This August, she would be 12 5/6 years old. She was 5'5" 3/4 inches tall, and she wore a number 7 shoe. In the past year, she had grown 4 inches, or at least that was what she judged. Already, the hateful little summer children hollered to her, "Is it cold up there?" And the comments of grown people made Frankie shrivel on her heels. If she reached her height on her 18th birthday, she had 5 1/6 growing years ahead of her. Therefore, according to mathematics, and unless she could somehow stop herself, she would grow to be over 9 feet tall. And what would be a lady who was over 9 feet high? She would be a freak. In the early autumn of every year, the Chattahoochee Exposition came to town. For a whole October week, the fair went on down at the fairgrounds. There was the Ferris wheel, the Flying Jinny, the Palace of Mirrors, and there too was the House of the Freaks. The House of the Freaks was a long pavilion, which was lined on the inside with a row of booths. It cost a quarter to go into the general tent, and you could look at each freak in his booth. Then there were special private exhibitions farther back in the tent, which cost a dime apiece. Frankie had seen all of the members of the Freak House last October. The giant, the fat lady, the midget, the wild nigger, the pinhead, the alligator boy, the half man, half woman. The giant was more than 8 feet high, with huge, loose hands and a hangjaw face. The fat lady sat in a chair, and the fat on her was like loose powdered dough, which she kept slapping and working with her hands. Next was the squeezed midget, who minced around in little trick evening clothes. The wild nigger came from a savage island. He squatted in his booth among the dusty bones and palm leaves, and he ate raw living rats. The fair gave a free admission to his show to all who brought rats of the right size, and so children carried them down in strong sacks and shoeboxes. The wild nigger knocked the rat's head over his squatted knee and ripped off the fur and crunched and gobbled and flashed his greedy wild nigger eyes. Some said that he was not a genuine wild nigger, but a crazy colored man from Selma. Anyway, Frankie did not like to watch him very long. She pushed through the crowd to the pinhead booth, where John Henry had stood all afternoon. The little pinhead skipped and giggled and sassed around, with a shrunken head no larger than an orange, which was shaved except for one lock tied with a pink bow at the top. The last booth was always very crowded, for it was the booth of the half-man, half-woman, a morphodite and a miracle of science. This freak was divided completely in half. The left side was a man, and the right side a woman. The costume on the left was a leopard skin, and on the right side a brassiere and a spangled skirt. Half the face was dark bearded, and the other half bright glazed with paint. Both eyes were strange. Frankie had wandered around the tent and looked at every booth. She was afraid of all the freaks, for it seemed to her that they had looked at her in a secret way and tried to connect their eyes with hers, as though to say, "We know you." She was afraid of their long freak eyes, and all the years she had remembered them until this day. "I doubt if they ever get married or go to a wedding," she said. "Those freaks."
"What freaks you talking about?" said Bernice.
"At the fair," said Frankie. "The ones we saw there last October."
"Oh, those folks. I wonder if they make a big salary," she said.
And Bernice answered, "How would I know?" John Henry held out an imaginary skirt, and, touching his finger to the top of his big head, he skipped and danced like the pinhead around the kitchen table. Then he said, "She was the cutest little girl I ever saw. I never saw anything so cute in my whole life. Did you, Frankie?"
"No," she said. "I didn't think she was cute."
"Me and you both," said Bernice.
"Shoo," John Henry argued. "She was, too."
"If you want my candy opinion," said Bernice, "that whole crowd of folks down yonder at the fair just give me the creeps, every last one of them."
Frankie watched Bernice through the mirror, and finally she asked in a slow voice,
Do I give you the creeps?
You, asked Bernice.
Do you think I'll grow into a freak? Frankie whispered.
You,
said Bernice again.
Why, certainly not. I trust Jesus.
Frankie felt better. She looked sideways at herself in the mirror. The clock ticked 6 slow times, and then she said,
well, do you think I'll be pretty?
Maybe, if you file down them horns 1 inch or 2.
Frankie stood with her weight resting on her left leg, and she slowly shuffled the ball of her right foot on the floor. She felt a splinter go beneath the skin.
Seriously, she said. I think when you fill out, you will do very well, if you behave.
But by Sunday, Frankie said, I want to do something to improve myself before the wedding.
Get clean for a change, scrub your elbows, fix yourself nice, you'll do very well.
Frankie looked for a last time at herself in the mirror, and then she turned away. She thought about her brother and the bride, and there was a tightness in her that would not break.
I don't know what to do. I just wish I could die.
Well, die then, said Bernice.
And die, John Henry echoed in a whisper. The world stopped. Go home, said Frankie to John Henry. He stood with his big knees locked, his dirty little hand on the edge of the white table, and he did not move.
You heard me, Frankie said. She made a terrible face at him and grabbed the frying pan that hung above the stove. She chased him 3 times around the table, then up through the front hall and out the door. She locked the front door and called again. Go home!
Now, what makes you act like that? Said Bernice.
You are too mean to live.
Frankie opened the door to the stairway that led up to her room and sat down on one of the lower steps. The kitchen was silent and crazy and sad.
I know it, she said. I intend to sit still by myself and think over everything for a while.
This was the summer when Frankie was sick and tired of being Frankie. She hated herself and had become a loafer and a big no-good who hung around the summer kitchen, dirty and greedy and mean and sad. Besides being too mean to live, she was a criminal. If the law knew about her, she could be tried in the courthouse and locked up in the jail. Yet, Frankie had not always been a criminal and a big no-good. Until the April of that year and all the years of her life before, she had been like other people. She belonged to a club and was in the 7th grade at school. She worked for her father on Saturday morning and went to the show every Saturday afternoon. She was not the kind of person ever to think of being afraid. At night, she slept in the bed with her father, but not because she was scared of the dark. Then, the spring of that year had been a long, queer season. Things began to change, and Frankie did not understand this change. After the plain gray winter, the March winds banged on the window panes, and clouds were sheared and white on the blue sky. April that year came sudden and still, and the green of the trees was a wild, bright green. The pale wisterias bloomed all over town, and silently the blossoms shattered. There was something about the green trees and the flowers of April that made Frankie sad. She did not know why she was sad, but because of this peculiar sadness, she began to realize she ought to leave the town. She read the war news and thought about the world and packed her suitcase to go away, but she did not know where she should go. It was the year when Frankie thought about the world, and she did not see it as a round school globe with the countries neat and different colored. She thought of the world as huge and cracked and loose and turning 1,000 miles an hour. The geography book at school was out of date. The countries of the world had changed. Frankie read the war news in the paper, but there were so many foreign places and the war was happening so fast that sometimes she did not understand. It was the summer when Patton was chasing the Germans across France, and they were fighting too in Russia and Saipan. She saw the battles and the soldiers, but there were too many different battles, and she could not see in her mind the millions and millions of soldiers all at once. She saw one Russian soldier, dark and frozen with a frozen gun in Russian snow. The single Jap with slanted eyes on a jungle island gliding among green vines. Europe and the people hung in the trees and the battleships on the blue oceans. Four motor planes and burning cities and a soldier in a steel war helmet laughing. Sometimes these pictures of the war, the world, whirled in her mind and she was dizzy. A long time ago, she had predicted that it would take 2 months to win the whole war. But now, she did not know. She wanted to be a boy and go to the war as a Marine. She thought about flying airplanes and winning gold medals for bravery. But she could not join the war, and this made her sometimes feel restless and blue. She decided to donate blood to the Red Cross. She wanted to donate a quart a week, and her blood would be in the veins of Australians and fighting French and Chinese all over the world, and it would be as though she were close kin to all of these people. She could hear the army doctor saying that the blood of Frankie Adams was the reddest and the strongest blood that they had ever known. And she could picture ahead in the years after the war, meeting the soldiers who had her blood, and they would say that they owed their life to her, and they would not call her Frankie. They would call her Adams. But this plan for donating her blood to the war did not come true. The Red Cross would not take her blood. She was too young. Frankie felt mad with the Red Cross and left out of everything. The war and the world were too fast and big and strange. To think about the world for very long made her afraid. She was not afraid of Germans or bombs or Japanese. She was afraid because in the war, they would not include her, and because the world seemed somehow separate from herself. So she knew she ought to leave the town and go to some place far away, for the late spring that year was lazy and too sweet. The long afternoons flowered and lasted, and the green sweetness sickened her. The town began to hurt Frankie. Sad and terrible happenings had never made Frankie cry, but this season, many things made Frankie suddenly wish to cry. Very early in the morning, she would sometimes go out into the yard and stand for a long time looking at the sunrise sky, and it was as though a question came into her heart, and the sky did not answer. Things she had never noticed much before began to hurt her. Home lights watched from the evening sidewalks, an unknown voice from an alley. She would stare at the lights and listen to the voice, and something inside her stiffened and waited. But the lights would darken, the voice fall silent, and though she waited, that was all. She was afraid of these things that made her suddenly wonder who she was and what she was going to be in the world and why she was standing at that minute, seeing a light or listening or staring up into the sky, alone. She was afraid, and there was a queer tightness in her chest. One night in April, when she and her father were going to bed, he looked at her and said, all of a sudden, "Who is this great, big, long-legged 12-year-old blunderbuss who still wants to sleep with her old papa?" And she was too big to sleep with her father anymore. She had to sleep in her upstairs room alone. She began to have a grudge against her father, and they looked at each other in a slant-eyed way. She did not like to stay at home. She went around town, and the things she saw and heard seemed to be left somehow unfinished. And there was the tightness in her that would not break. She would hurry to do something, but what she did was always wrong. She would call her best friend, Evelyn Owen, who owned a football suit and a Spanish shawl, and one would dress in the football suit and the other in the Spanish shawl, and they would go down to the 10-cent store together. But that was a wrong thing, and not what Frankie wanted. Or after the pale spring twilights, with the smell of dust and flowers sweet and bitter in the air, evenings of lighted windows and the long-drawn calls at supper time, when the chimney swifts had gathered and whirled above the town and flown off somewhere to their home together, leaving the sky empty and wide. After the long twilights of this season, when Frankie had walked around the sidewalks of the town, a jazz sadness quivered her nerves and her heart stiffened and almost stopped. Because she could not break this tightness gathering within her, she would hurry to do something. She would go home and put the coal scuttle on her head like a crazy person's hat and walk around the kitchen table. She would do anything that suddenly occurred to her, but whatever she did was always wrong and not at all what she had wanted. Then, having done these wrong and silly things, she would stand sickened and empty in the kitchen door and say, "I just wish I could tear down this whole town." "Well, tear it down then, but quit hanging around here with that gloomy face. Do something." And finally, the trouble started. She did things and she got herself in trouble. She broke the law, and having once become a criminal, she broke the law again and then again. She took the pistol from her father's bureau drawer and carried it all over town and shot up the cartridges in a vacant lot. She changed into a robber and stole a three-way knife from the Sears and Roebuck store. One Saturday afternoon, she committed a secret and unknown sin. In the McKean's garage, with Barney McKean, they committed a queer sin, and how bad it was, she did not know. The sin made a shriveling sickness in her stomach, and she dreaded the eyes of everyone. She hated Barney and wanted to kill him. Sometimes alone in the bed at night, she planned to shoot him with a pistol or throw a knife between his eyes. Her best friend, Evelyn Owen, moved away to Florida, and Frankie did not play with anybody anymore. The long and flowering spring was over, and the summer in the town was ugly and lonesome and very hot. Every day she wanted more and more to leave the town, to light out for South America or Hollywood or New York City. But although she packed her suitcase many times, she could never decide to which of these places she ought to go or how she would get there by herself. So she stayed home and hung around the kitchen, and the summer did not end. By dog day, she was 5'5" 3/4 inches tall, a great big greedy loafer who was too mean to live. She was afraid, but not as she had been before. There was only the fear of Barney, her father, and the law. But even these fears were finally gone. After a long time, the sin in the McKean's garage became far from her and was remembered only in her dreams. And she would not think of her father or the law. She stuck close in the kitchen with John Henry and Bernice. She did not think about the war, the world. Nothing hurt her any longer. She did not care. She never stood alone in the backyard in order to stare up at the sky. She paid no attention to sounds and summer voices and did not walk the streets of town at night. She would not let things make her sad, and she would not care. She ate and wrote shows and practiced throwing knives against the side of the garage and played bridge at the kitchen table. Each day was like the day before, except that it was longer and nothing hurt her anymore. So that Sunday, when it happened, when her brother and the bride came to the house, Frankie knew that everything was changed. But why this was so and what would happen to her next, she did not know. And though she tried to talk with Bernice, Bernice did not know either. "It gives me this kind of pain," she said, "to think about them." "Well, don't," said Bernice. "You done nothing but think and carry on about them all this afternoon." Frankie sat at the bottom step of the stairs to her room, staring into the kitchen. But although it gave her a kind of pain, she had to think about the wedding. She remembered the way her brother and the bride had looked when she walked into the living room that morning at 11 o'clock. There had been in the house a sudden silence, for Jarvis had turned off the radio when they came in, after the long summer, when the radio had gone on day and night, so that no one heard it anymore. The curious silence had startled Frankie. She stood in the doorway, coming from the hall, and the first sight of her brother and the bride had shocked her heart. Together they made in her this feeling that she could not name, but it was like the feelings of the spring, only more sudden and more sharp. There was the same tightness, and in the same queer way she was afraid. Frankie thought until her mind was dizzy and her foot had gone to sleep. Then she asked Bernice, "How old were you when you married your first husband?"
While Frankie was thinking, Bernice had changed into her Sunday clothes, and now she sat reading a magazine. She was waiting for the people who were due to meet her at 6 o'clock, Honey and T.T. Williams. The three of them were going to eat supper at the new Metropolitan Tea Room and sashay together around the town. As Bernice read, she moved her lips to shape each word. Her dark eye looked up as Frankie spoke, but since Bernice did not raise her head, the blue glass eye seemed to go on reading the magazine. This two-sided expression bothered Frankie.
"Our 13 years old," said Bernice.
"What made you get married so young for?"
"Because I wanted to," said Bernice. "Our 13 years old and I haven't grown an inch since."
Bernice was very short, and Frankie looked hard at her and asked, "Does Marion really stop your growth?"
"It certain do," said Bernice.
"I didn't know that," Frankie said.
Bernice had been married 4 different times. Her first husband was Ludie Freeman, a brick mason, and the favorite and best one of the 4. He gave Bernice her fox fur, and once they had gone to Cincinnati and seen snow. Bernice and Ludie Freeman had seen a whole winter of northern snow. They loved each other and were married for 9 years, until the November he was sick and died. The other 3 husbands were all bad, each one worse than the one before, and it made Frankie blue just to hear about them. The first was a sorry old liquor drinker. The next went crazy on Bernice. He did crazy things, had eating dreams in the night, and swallowed a corner of his sheet. And what with one thing and another, he distracted Bernice so much that finally she had to quit him. The last husband was terrible. He gouged out Bernice's eye and stole her furniture away from her. She had to call the law on him.
"Did you marry with a veil every time?" asked Frankie.
2 times with a veil," said Bernice.
Frankie could not keep still. She walked around the kitchen, although there was a splinter in her right foot, and she was limping, her thumbs hooked in the belt of her shorts and her undershirt clinging and wet. Finally, she opened the drawer of the kitchen table and selected a long, sharp butcher knife. Then she sat down and rested the ankle of her sore foot on her left knee. The sole of her foot was long and narrow, pitted with ragged, whitish scars, as every summer Frankie stepped on many nails. Frankie had the toughest feet in town. She could slice off waxy yellow rinds from the bottom of her feet, and it did not hurt her very much, although it would hurt other people. But she did not chisel for the splinter immediately. She just sat there, her ankle on her knee, and the knife in her right hand, looking across the table at Bernice.
"Tell me," she said, "tell me exactly how it was."
"You know," said Bernice, "you've seen them."
"But tell me," Frankie said.
"I will discuss it for the last time," said Bernice. "Your brother and the bride come late this morning, and you and John Henry hurry in from the backyard to see him. The next thing I realize, you bust back through the kitchen and run up to your room. You came down with your organdy dress on and lipstick an inch thick from one ear to the next. Then you all just sat around in the living room. It was hot. Jarvis had brought Mr. Adams a bottle of whiskey, and they had liquor drinks, and you and John Henry had lemonade. Then, after dinner, your brother and the bride took the 3 o'clock train back to Winter Hill. The wedding will be this coming Sunday, and that is all. Now, is you satisfied?"
"I am so disappointed they couldn't stay any longer, at least spend the night, after Jarvis being away so long. I guess they want to be together as long as they can. Jarvis said he had some army papers to fill out in Winter Hill." She took a deep breath. "I wonder where they'll go after the wedding."
"On their honeymoon. Your brother will have a few days leave."
"I wonder where that honeymoon will be."
"Well, I'm sure I don't know."
"Tell me," Frankie said again, "exactly what did they look like?"
"Look like?" said Bernice. "Why, they look natural,"
Your brother's a good-looking blonde white boy, and the girl's kind of brunette and small and pretty. They make a nice white couple. You seen them? Foolish.
Frankie closed her eyes, and though she did not see them as a picture, she could feel them leaving her. She could feel the two of them together on the train, riding and riding away from her. They were them and leaving her, and she was her and sitting left all by herself there at the kitchen table. But a part of her was with them, and she could feel this part of her own self going away and farther away, farther and farther, so that a drawn-out sickness came in her, going away and farther away, so that the kitchen Frankie was an old hall left there at the table.
It's so queer, she said.
She bent over the sole of her foot, and there was something wet like tears or sweat drops on her face. She sniffled and began to cut for the splinter.
Don't that hurt you none? Asked Bernice.
Frankie shook her head and did not answer. Then after a moment she said,
Have you ever seen any people that afterward you remembered more like a feeling than a picture?
How do you mean?
I mean this, said Frankie slowly. I saw them okay. Janice had on a green dress and a green high-heeled Danish shoes. Her hair was done up in a knot, dark hair, and a little piece of it was loose.
Jarvis sat by her on the sofa. He had on his brown uniform, and he was sunburned and very clean. They were the two prettiest people I ever saw. Yet it was like I couldn't see all of them I wanted to see. My brains couldn't gather together quick enough and take it all in, and then they were gone. See what I mean?
You're hurting yourself, said Bernice. What you need is a needle.
Oh, I don't care anything about my old feet, Frankie said.
It was only 6:30, and the minutes of the afternoon were like bright mirrors. From outside, there was no longer the sound of whistling, and in the kitchen, nothing moved. Frankie sat facing the door that opened onto the back porch. There was a square cat hole cut in a corner of the back door, and nearby a saucer of lavender sour milk. In the beginning of dog days, Frankie's cat had gone away. And the season of dog days is like this. It is the time at the end of the summer when, as a rule, nothing can happen. But if a change does come about, that change remains until dog days are over. Things that are done are not undone, and a mistake once made is not corrected. That August, Bernice scratched a mosquito bite under her right arm, and it became a sore that would never heal until dog days were over. Two little families of August gnats picked out the corner of John Henry's eyes to settle down in, and though he often shook himself and blinked, those gnats were there to stay. Then Charles disappeared. Frankie did not see him leave the house and walk away, but on the 14th of August, when she called him to his supper, he did not come, and he was gone. She looked for him everywhere and sent John Henry wailing out his name through all the streets of town. But it was the season of dog days, and Charles did not come back again. Every afternoon, Frankie said exactly the same words to Bernice, and the answers of Bernice were always the same. So that now the words were like an ugly little tune they sang by heart. If only I just knew where he has gone. Quit worrying yourself about that old alley cat. I done told you he ain't coming back.
Charles is not alley. He's almost pure Persian.
Persian as I is, Bernice would say. You seen the last of that old tomcat. He gone off to hunt a friend.
To hunt a friend?
Why, certainly. He roamed off to find himself a lady friend.
You really think so?
Naturally.
Well, why don't he bring his friend home with him? He ought to know I'd be only too glad to have a whole family of cats.
You seen the last of that old alley cat.
If only I just knew where he is gone.
And so, each gloomy afternoon, their voices sawed against each other, saying the same words which finally reminded Frankie of a raggedy rhyme said by two crazies. She would end by telling Bernice, "It looks to me like everything's just walked off and left me." And she would put her head down on the table and feel afraid. But this afternoon, Frankie suddenly changed all this. An idea came to her, and she put down the knife and got up from the table.